Hi everybody, it's me, Dr. Kestler from Lorain County Community College with today's COVIDio. My temperature today is 96 degrees or 35.6. It's a little bit higher than usual, but I do have a little bit more to say about my temperature being on the low side. And I get to give a quick shout out to my friend and citizen scientist, Diane, who pointed out something about a condition that I have. I have Hashimoto's thyroidosis. I am missing a thyroid gland due to it's a kind of an autoimmune disorder. I don't have a thyroid gland right now. And one of the conditions, one of the side effects of this is apparently low temperature, low body temperature. And this is a study from a physician. This is not actually a study. This is a little bit of an anecdotal presentation. In other words, he sees a lot of patients and he notices that they have a low body temperature. So I just thought I'd throw that in there because I know people are interested. That's that. I want to spend a little bit of time talking about China because China, what's going on in China is our future. I've heard a lot of people say, well, the China is the numbers that we get from China are not quite accurate. And I think I said this a long time ago, but I do want to address it. All the numbers are inaccurate except the deaths. The deaths are more accurate than the cases because cases are subject to testing. And if you're not testing, you're not testing accurately, you're not testing the right people, you're not getting accurate data about the number of cases. Nevertheless, we do use those as sort of a representation, and it's important to look at the increases of the cases, or the decreases, or the leveling off. And I think, as you can see from this chart here, that there is, first of all, let me just anecdotally report this. One of my students' family lives in outside of Wuhan City in China. And she shared with me a video this weekend of life returning normal to this town, and it was a scene from a supermarket. And I think that life is returning to a lot of portions of China right now. And the question is that, you know, if you look at this curve that I have up here, you'll notice that there seems to be a little bit of a blip up. Way far out in between April 7th and April 11th. And that is true. There is a little bit of a blip going up there. And it's totally expected. The key to opening up, and that's what everybody wants to know, when do we get to open up? When do we go back to doing our regular things, going to our Starbucks and all the things that we want to do when this is all over, going to the gym, whatever. So that is totally expected. We are going to expect, remember, the majority of the people in the United States and the majority of the people in China have not been infected with this virus. So that means that they are still susceptible to getting infected with the virus. And so unless we very carefully test, testing is the answer to getting out. Opening up depends on testing. Opening up depends on knowing who is who. And not only just testing, but knowing who is positive, knowing who is positive recovered, that becomes very important later on. And that becomes very important in knowing whether how well we are recovering. Also, it enables you, if I turn up positive tomorrow, we can do something called basically looking for contact tracing. And if we contact my traces, we can put those people in quarantine for a short period of time, having a small number of people in positive quarantine. Positive quarantine is when you're quarantining somebody because they are ill, as opposed to negative quarantine, which is what we're doing right now. Everybody is staying in, the healthy people stay in. If we can move to a system where we positively quarantine those that are infected, then we will be in a much better place. We will be in a place where we can go back pretty much to normal and control the virus. We'll still have to worry about susceptible places, no doubt. All right. Now I want to go on to something else. This is also something that I am looking at, and this is Korea. Korea has much fewer cases than we do, about 50 times less cases than, or no, 100 times, 105,000 times, or 500 times less than we do, total cases, so small number of cases. However, you'll see that they've been, they look like they're about to plateau on this linear scale here. And looks like they have almost plateaued a couple of times. So they're still struggling and they're still testing. I want to point out something else about this story, and that is that they're seeing people who are small number, small fraction of the people who are recovered, air quote, are testing positive again. That's for testing positive for the actual virus being present at that time. And and I think you may see some things like this in the future. You may see those kinds of things. It is not surprising. But this is not the usual. We recover from epidemics. We do. We have been recovering from epidemics, from pandemics, since we have been on this island. And that's how we have survived. That's how our species has survived by, and all species have survived, because we have that ability to mount immune responses. Is everybody's immune response the same? No. Are there some people who get it twice? I would bet anything there would be, yes. But that is not the norm. We get over epidemics. So just because you see something, it might be unusual. For instance, a lot of students said I had the chicken pox twice. And that's always kind of interesting when a student has the chicken pox twice. But there's also plenty of others who don't have it twice, who have it once and never get it the second time. So that is something that's fully expected. All right, let me leave you with what's going on here in Ohio. I was just listening to the governor and Dr. Amy Atkin about in Ohio the cases, and we appear to be, as you can see, although the cases, they're still preliminary, looks like both cases and deaths appear to be plateauing. And if they are plateauing, that means we're getting to the peak point. And as soon as we bring those cases down, we can start looking at, as soon as we bring the number of new cases down, rather, and as soon as we bring the deaths down, we can start thinking very well about reopening. But again, I'll just, one more thing, we've got to have that testing piece. We've got to know who, and by the way, getting back to the story that I presented a second ago in South Korea, in order to adequately know if people are truly becoming positive a second, we need accurate testing data. We need lots of testing data to know what the actual frequency of this phenomenon is. So these are things that more knowledge is better in this situation. All right. And I will just remind everybody that on Saturday I talked about shared sacrifice and how a whole generation, the generation that we're trying to protect right now, knows about shared sacrifice. They all work together to defeat an enemy. And we're doing it too. And it doesn't seem like we're doing much by staying home. But, you know, I understand people are suffering. But we will emerge from this better. We will we will figure some things out going out of this. Hopefully we are not going to return to normal. I'm hoping we return better. I'm hoping that we fix some things. This is obviously a situation that has exposed lots of problems in our healthcare system and on both sides of the healthcare system. And I hope we can fix it and we can all be helpers. I would just like to remind you to be good to each other, especially when you're inside and you know you've been trapped with somebody inside in the same house for a long, long period of time. They can kind of grow on you. But be good to each other and may you persist like a lentivirus.